Hey everybody, Bob Babbitt here. Welcome to Breakfast with Bob from Challenge Daytona and the PTO 2020 Championship. We are brought to you by Captiva Spine, John Hall Chevrolet, USA Triathlon, Foundation Risk Partners, and the PTO, the Pro Triathletes Organization. Our next guest, 11-time Ironman champion, Lisa Bentley. How are you?
I'm good. I'm glad I get my yearly dose of Bob Babbitt. We need more Bob Babbitts in the world.
You are a captain, right, for the Collins Cup for, what, the international team?
Yep, I'm one of the four international captains for the Collins Cup, and we're looking forward to May and getting that Collins Cup off the ground.
So you are, you know, obviously from Canada, but living down here, being at this track and seeing this utilized for triathlon, how cool is that?
It's amazing. And it's in the fact that this race has come together on such a grand scale.
Yes.
Shows the essence really of 2020, which is, you know, pivot, adapt, show resiliency. And that's exactly what has been shown here. And triathletes, the best triathletes in the world are here racing and safely, not the wild, wild west. It's safe.
They're doing a good job.
It's exciting.
And we're both in masks. You are high risk with cystic fibrosis. And this, how scary has it been? I mean, even in Florida, which has been a little bit of an outlaw state in terms of shutting things down, how scary has it been for you?
It's certainly been 9 months of anxiety.
Yeah.
That said, it's only as scary as the situations you put yourself in.
Right.
And I remember, you know, Canada has been very good with rules, and Ontario and Toronto, where I live. And I remember when things start to open up and the pools start to open up and the change rooms were open, and someone said, oh, Lisa, you know, the change room's open, you can use it. And I said, well, just because it's open doesn't make it safe.
Right.
So I'm going to sort of bypass that right now and just jump into my car kind of thing. So the perspective we've taken in Florida is just because something's open doesn't make it safe. And so we like to say we're still living in phase 1.5. That, you know, we go get our groceries when the grocery store opens at 7 a.m. and we're diligent not to run out for one thing. You know, Christmas cards, birthday cards, anniversary cards, non-essential service.
You know,
we're just, you know, we're making cards, we're getting creative, and, you know, we're just going to look forward to 2021 and being healthy and keeping our families healthy and others around us.
So when you were diagnosed, were you already an adult? Was it something that came when it was like 1988 or so? Mm-hmm. Was that when you were diagnosed?
Yeah, I was diagnosed when I was around 20, and it is it's genetic, so
right.
You're born with it. So I had it my whole life, but we didn't know, and I was just the allergic kid that got bleeding noses and was sick all the time.
And once you found out, and at that point, triathlon was already as part of your life, and trying to balance what you're dealing with to being a professional triathlete, being at the highest level of the sport, how were you able to do that?
Yeah, you know, I really did have to take good care of my health. So ironically, when the pandemic came, it was like, yeah, well, I already don't touch anything.
You know, right, you're already sheltering in place.
Yeah, exactly. I was at phase 2.5 then. Now I'm phase 1.5. But yeah, I mean, I've always been super careful in taking care of my health and taking supplements and antioxidants. And I've always been, you know, a healthy eater. I eat, you know, broccoli every single day and trying to do my part. But, you know, basically when I get sick, you know, that's it. I have to go on antibiotics or inhale therapies and deal with it. And, you know, as I say to people, that cystic fibrosis really was my superpower. And I really believe, really believe that I wouldn't have won 11 Ironmans
really?
Without it. And that's a bold statement when your lungs are your engine and you need your lungs to get yourself the finish line ahead of everybody else. But you see, I had purpose every single time I raced.
Because you knew there were people out there with cystic fibrosis who needed hope and needed somebody to show them that you can live a life.
Absolutely. And we all have that power. And so, you know, of course I was a competitor. And of course I wanted to get the finish line first, or at least the best that I could. But I knew no matter where I was, I had a reason to put a step forward.
Right.
And besides just trying to win the race. And so, you know yourself, having done Ironman, that there's sometimes you're in a position where it's like, oh my gosh, my day, you know, I'm not going to win. I'm not going to be on the podium. But you might be. And so I had that underlying gift of saying, hey, you know, if I just keep going, I'm going to give hope to a family. And I might just get to the finish line first. So even in the most dire times, you know, getting off the bike 15 minutes down, I was able to pull out a victory and cross the finish line first. But even more, I was able to give that hope. So for me, it was it is a blessing, and it's given me purpose to my career, a career which can often be very selfish.
Very selfish, yeah. So it gave you, so in these races, there was something for you to draw on when you listen. I'm way behind, and I need to run my way through the field, but I know someone's watching.
Exactly, wow. and that is very, very, very powerful.
When you look back at your career, and you have 11 wins, is there one that sticks out the most? Mm-hmm. Is there one race that you look at, and maybe it wasn't a win, that this was the best race Lisa Bentley ever had?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was, certainly Ironman Australia, my fourth time there, going there and trying to win it for the fourth time in a row, and everything went wrong, everything. I, you know, had a thumbtack in my foot before the race started. I got punched in the eye 400 meters into the swim, had a black eye, lost my nutrition on the bike, and I realized 400 meters into that swim, after, you know, the third obstacle,
right,
that was going to be the obstacle race. That was the race I was really going to prove that I'm a champion. Because that's, you know, a champion isn't just the person that crosses the finish line first. It's the person that can turn adversity into success.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, oh, this is my opportunity. And so instead of going, oh my gosh, my race is over, or, you know, the world is against me, I said, hey, this is an opportunity where I actually get to prove to myself that I deserve that title of champion. And I pressed through, and I changed my theme to, hey, bring it on, you know, give me a problem to solve. And, you know, I ended up being able to win that race. And I was very, very proud of that race, because if I'd have crossed the finish line in 10th, I would have won.
Right.
It didn't matter, because yeah, I had not quit. And that's what it's about. It's about not quitting. You know, this life is hard. You know, life is really hard. How many of us have wanted to quit this year? And, you yeah, know, we want it over with. And sport is such a great venue to say no. Like, you don't quit. You push through, and you get what you get, but
you
do your best.
You adapt to what's happening. So, Collins Cup, very cool concept. We're talking the internationals, we're talking the Europeans, we're talking the Americans, teams from each country, similar to a Davis Cup format. When it was first explained to you what's going on, we want you to be a captain of the international team, what were your thoughts?
I was just so honored, and I love that. I mean, I love the sport. I, like you, have those deep, deep roots that we just love
yeah,
this sport. And you know, it's neat because we bring it onto the same level as golf, in a sense, which is a beloved sport, mm-hmm, that you can do for your whole life. So they have so much similarity. It's sport for life. And it's going to be on a great stage, and it's going to be fun, and we're going to get to sink our teeth into it and be the first group to do something so innovative. And people are going to be watching, and I think it's going to be so amazing for our sport, for the community, bringing the world together on a stage that isn't the Olympics. It's neat.
I've heard that Lionel Sanders has already made a request that he wants to go head-to-head with Jan Frodeno in the Collins
that.
Cup.
I love that.
Is that the best? Say, give me the best guy and let me go after him.
And that's what it's about. You know, it's, of course, it's about matchups, and you want to be strategic, but I think we have to give the world what they want to see, which
yes,
is the best head-to-head. And let's showcase our sport and let's make it big. And I think it will be. It will be.
Oh,
I mean,
no question,
we're starving for it.
Yeah. This event, I don't think you've ever, when you were racing, I don't think there was ever anything like this, where you got the ITU athletes, you got world champions, you got Ironman champions, you got 70.3 champions all coming together in one venue to see who is the best with $1 million on the line. As a long time athlete in the sport, how special is this whole concept?
I love this concept. I love that this has come together, and this opportunity exists for the athletes and for all of us lovers of the sport. It would have, you know, I wish it was 10 years earlier. I wish I could be out there racing,
right,
because it would be so darn exciting to be here and being able to do my best. But I am blessed that I get to be here 10 years after retiring and be hopefully a bit of a support to the athletes, and definitely be here embracing a sport that I love so much.
So we were doing a little contest a couple months ago and asking people to pick their favorite moments from Ironman over the years. And your moment was one of my favorites, and obviously one of yours. For our viewers out there, what was your favorite moment?
It was my last race at Ironman Hawaii, and I was, you know, going to be one of my last races. I wasn't actually even going to do the race because I had had this terrible Achilles injury, and I crossed the finish line at Ironman Canada. I said, I'm not going to race Hawaii. Do not let me race Hawaii. Handcuff me. Just don't let me go. And I got this letter from a mother with her son with cystic fibrosis. His name's Carter, and at the time he was six, and he made a wish to the Make-A-Wish Foundation that he wanted to cross the finish line with me at the Ironman World Championships in Hawaii. And his mother said, I know you're injured, but I still hope you're doing Hawaii this year because the Make-A-Wish Foundation granted his wish.
Oh my God, not much pressure.
Not much pressure. And my whole career has been about trying to make a difference,
yeah,
trying to be that bit of hope. And so
you had
this was my job description.
Right, exactly.
I needed to do that. And so called up all my sports doctors, physiotherapists, and said, okay, you got 6 weeks of work to go and let's get ready. And I, that race was brilliant. It was probably one of my slowest, not intentionally. I was definitely doing my best. But got to that finish line, saw Carter 100 meters from the finish line. We crossed the line together. And the photo I sent to you is a picture of me with my hands cupped around his face. And I don't even remember it. And someone took a photo, not even an official photographer. And it's a really special photo,
yeah,
not just because it looks amazing, but, you know, two people with cystic fibrosis don't touch,
right,
because of,
yeah,
the ease at which you can give an infection. But it was, all rules were off.
Right.
And it was an incredible moment. And I'm happy to say Carter is very healthy. He's in university right now. He downhill skis. He's healthy. He's happy. And very fully, fully alive. And that speaks to doctors, research, and hope. And it's all about that hope. So, yeah, that was an incredibly special moment in it. And one of the highlights of my career.
Yeah, well, and for me, what it highlights is that our athletes understand the importance of giving back,
mm-hmm,
and understanding that it's more than swim, bike, and run.
Mm-hmm.
That it has a big meaning.
Absolutely.
Thank you for everything you bring to the sport. Always such a pleasure to get to chat. I'm excited that we'll be together at Collins Cup in May, hopefully, over in Sommerin.
We will. I look forward to it.
And we'll have a lot of fun watching these guys go in circles.
So, I know. I love it. Good luck to all the athletes. And everyone's going to have a great time. Welcome back, triathlon, to your houses. Watch with Ernest on Sunday. It's an incredible gift.
Lisa Bentley has been our guest, everybody. My name is Bob Babbitt. This is Challenge Daytona, the PTO 2020 Championship. Hold on. We will be right back.